committee meeting.
Yeah.
May 9th, 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And we are ready to start.
That's right, an open meeting.
Open meeting.
All right, first order of business would be to set a chair and a clerk.
Correct. Can we have a conversation first?
Of course you may.
Okay, so Brenda and I spoke, and I kind of felt, or we kind of felt that co-chairs,
yes,
because of our busy schedules,
mm-hmm,
would work best for us. Of course, we all have to agree on that.
Well, can I ask a question?
Sure.
I thought there were supposed to be five of us.
There is.
There is five. We do have another member that has a business commitment, and it's been like a year-long thing that she did bring to the attention of David. And she was told that, you know, it's okay.
And who is that person?
Valerie Hood.
Valerie Hood.
Okay.
The commitments are just Thursday or always? Mostly she's committed just to this.
Well, it seems like every meeting she's out of town. My personal opinion is that I feel this board, because of the ups and downs, that we need presence and consistency. And so I felt, I don't know how to go about it, you know, reach out to her to, you know, I did speak to Brian West on how this all works, you know, reach out to her if, is this something that, you know, she's, her schedule's going to lighten up, and is this something that she can commit to? You know, my work schedule, I can't, well, I missed last night's meeting. I understand that, you know, we can't, but, you know, once or in a year, and this is, you know, you're always playing catch up, in my opinion. So I don't know how that works.
Mm-hmm.
She did reach out to you.
Yep.
So what's your thoughts on it?
So my thoughts is that now you have a committee of four active. She's got business commitments that are going to keep her busy until June. She came to me, she said that she would like to work actively with the town starting in June, but she's going to be pretty scarce in between. So we can have a conversation with her about, you know, does this continue to make sense? Is there somebody else who really would like to have a place at the table? And we can have her decide whether she wants to remain or not. We don't have the authority. No one has the authority to take her off. She has to decide.
Right.
To step down.
So is that something we could, you know, like one of us or Amy,
yeah,
or
so,
one of us could, you know, ask her? Or?
I think she'd appreciate that.
Yeah, because, you know, obviously if she wants to make that commitment and stay, that's, you know, we want her to.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I wasn't sure how long this business commitment was going to be.
So I travel for business, not super often, but I do it. But at this time of night, I would be in a hotel room by now somewhere if I was away. There's Skype, there's phone calls, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, some of my business meetings at work are person, computer, and the people are on there,
mm-hmm,
you know, from wherever they are. So maybe she can do something like that as well.
Mm-hmm. She runs a massage school.
Yeah, so that's what, yeah.
But she,
and
I mean, I'm sure she has.
Hearing impaired,
yes,
so
hearing.
I don't know. Although it's tough for her, so
we,
I mean,
do,
I guess
we
can address that.
We do have
that.
A remote participation policy. And offer it. That's a good suggestion. I keep on forgetting about these computers.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter where you are, really.
Right.
As long as your voice and your face are there, I guess that's all you really.
Yeah, that's true. I never really kind of thought that. She might want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
All right, so I'll send her an email tomorrow, and I'll send her the remote participation policy.
Can you send that to us, too? Because
yeah,
I'm not familiar with that.
Yeah.
I mean, is it restrictive, or what's the... I assume we have Wi-Fi in this building.
Yes, we do. So the main thing is not the technology, but the open meeting law, and making sure that we're covered for issues having to do with quorum. All right, so that's what the policy addresses, so.
As well as like.
Quorum and voting.
When we send emails out to each other, if you're asking questions, it can't be like group emails because we're not, you know, you don't want it, that would be against the open meeting law type thing.
Transparency.
Right. So if you wanted to ask me a question, you could ask me a question one-on-one type thing, or Amy, or vice versa, but you can't, you know, hit the group response.
So that's just for like scheduling and things of that nature?
Yeah, you can ask me or Linda questions. That's not a problem.
Okay.
They could be substantive questions.
So I guess to go back, I don't have the, I was trying to look it up, the agenda that we sent out, but to, if you all agree that Amy and I could do that together.
Yeah.
Then.
I would agree to that. I certainly don't want to do it yet.
Right.
So
I might be senior, but
so much
I'm
for
still
open meeting law.
So I guess we would have to take a vote on that. So somebody would have to make that motion other than us two. So the motion would be that we vote to make myself, and maybe co-chairs.
All right, I'll make that motion.
On the Finance Committee.
Seconded.
And then all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, there we go. We just both decided.
And you guys can't vote on that because it's.
They can vote on it.
Okay, can. But so we both, let's just say that we both agreed to do it because neither one of us like to stand up in front of people and talk.
Oh, okay. Well, presumably that has to happen at town meeting.
It does.
And we do. Terry notes.
And we do. And she writes the notes. Like,
I tell her what to say. Go say it.
So that's the way that works. But
it's the whole Cyrano de Bergerac thing.
Yeah. So then the next person would have to be. You said what, clerk?
Clerk, somebody and, who's taking minutes.
Yeah, somebody who take minutes. So I was doing that, and I have minutes, but I never have, like, formed them into once I want to, put on the website, and I have to do that. And I will do the catch-up, but I don't feel like, with my work commitment, that I can continue to do that. So somebody else would have to. It doesn't have to be, like, really detailed, but just the motions, have to be written down and clear on what we're voting on.
And the vote itself.
Yeah, the vote itself.
I didn't know you were doing that before.
I was. Actually, I have lots of notes. And then Linda sent me the letterhead.
Okay.
So, yeah. Nice. So if we need somebody to volunteer to do that. You're good at
it. Good typer.
You're good? All right. Yeah, excellent.
This is working out great.
Yeah, you can bring your laptop when we're doing it. So.
Yeah.
And then once they're done, we bring them to the next meeting, vote on them, and then we can submit them to, will we send them to you?
So you can or submit them to Jessica.
Okay.
Yeah, the town clerk.
Okay. All right, so the motion is to?
Well, the motion is to nominate or to have Gabriel be the clerk.
Second.
Excellent.
Aye.
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right.
Aye. So you have to write that down. That's part of the minutes. Okay.
Tell we're a green board.
All right. So next was Amy. What did we want to have David go over?
Do you want to switch seats?
No, we're good.
Okay.
Okay, so then the next thing we were going to do is just, I think, have David go over a lot of this stuff with us.
Right.
Yeah, that'd be good to get us out of the. So I feel like I came into this in the two-thirds of the way in.
Okay. So I thought it would be helpful if we just went through the revenues, which are on page 33. Briefly touch upon the expenses. I'm not going to go through the departments. You're going to hear them firsthand yourself.
33, sir? 33. Thanks. Did a lot of the departments, did the select board invited all the department heads to come in and not like, kind of like a wish list of what they wanted to see happen?
So the selectmen back in December set some priorities.
Right.
You know, the public safety being an important one, consolidation of the building maintenance program into one budget was another one. They were concerned about OPEB. They were concerned about IT. They were concerned about human resources and finance director position. So some of which is funded and some of which is not in this current budget.
Did anything come about of that? Did they vote on anything, or was it just informational, or?
They voted that back on December 1st, I think it was. That went out as budget instructions to the departments. The departments and I met several times in November and December. And then I produced this document starting in October, ending up at the end of January.
And so this is with whatever was discussed there, and it's kind of formulated in the book. Okay.
Okay.
That's good. Thank you.
So
can I ask a stupid question?
Of course you may.
Our fiscal year starts when?
July 1st. Okay. July 1st to June 3rd.
What kind of public participation is there in the prioritization on behalf of the select board? I mean, obviously they're going to be talking with the residents, but is there any kind of documentation about what citizens have requested so that we can also get a sense of?
Yeah, we're just beginning to do that. We haven't done that in the past. Obviously, the selectmen make their priorities known in an open meeting. But we're now beginning to have all board meetings once a year, twice a year. We're also beginning to have public forums on the warrants coming up. So we had one for the fall town meeting. We have one planned for the annual town meeting. This is new and different for us. So.
And that's all in person, that's recorded and broadcast, but anything
right.
In writing or anything online where people can?
Just the information that's on the the board docs as well as the budget book that I produce is on my website.
The forum seemed to work real well the first time we tested it. It allows the general consensus to get a look at everything we're discussing prior to the town meeting, and you take out a lot of the problematic areas by doing that. The tough questions get answered that night, and town meeting moves a lot smoother.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the length isn't anywhere near as long when you do that.
Cool.
But that is one of the priorities of the select board, is to be more transparent and reach out to the public more than they have in the past. Still learning. If there's any insights that you have, we certainly want to hear about them.
If you want to catch up on anything, I go out on YouTube and I watch it on TV.
Yep.
Yeah.
So all these are on YouTube? That's where they can be found?
Is all of it on YouTube or just the highlights?
Usually it's the whole meeting.
The whole meeting.
Yep.
Okay.
That's all the different boards?
No, you do the school committee, select board, planning board, finance committee.
Right.
That's about it. Yeah.
Well, this is the first one for the finance committee that's been recorded, right?
Right.
Since I've been here.
Right.
So
they haven't been at the safety complex.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is new for us.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good thing, because you can look back ahead and say, oh,
there you go for your minutes.
Shouldn't have said that.
Yes.
Actually, that's what I do for work. Look back at it.
You know, in essence, you're appointed by the moderator, and it makes you a neutral party representing solely the taxpayers. You're taken out of the political arena. You're not elected officials or anything like that. So you can be neutral on this whole budget to analyze it and come up with your own opinions. And that's the purpose of the moderator appointing you. And they're not being elected. Some towns do have elected finance committees, but Hadley chooses not to do it that way.
But we're here to work with the select board as well, and come up with the best idea.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't want two sides not working well together. So the goal is to be able to work well with each other and come with our common goal is to do what's best for the residents of Hadley.
Okay. So let's take a look at the revenues. I'm just going to walk through these quickly. If you have questions, feel free to stop me. But I wanted to give you the broad contours of each revenue type. And there are four revenue types that we'll be discussing. You'll see that they're summarized as Table 1, Table 2, Table 3, and Table 4. Table 1 is the property tax. Okay, somehow I'm getting involved in a conversation. So property tax, this is how much tax money that we're going to be raising in FY18. And this is where the provisions of Proposition 2.5 apply. And so just to walk through the formula, if you see at the FY2018 projected, there's a number 10,157 and change. That number is comprised of three prior year's numbers. The tax levy from FY17 plus the 2.5% plus the new growth figure. If you add those first three numbers together in FY17, you come up with that 10,157 and change at the top of 18. So that's a formula, just plug and play. So that is your base taxes for 18. The next number down there, 253,000 and change, that is your Proposition 2.5 increase, which is allowed by law. The next number is 142,000 and change. That is what's called new growth, and that's anything that expands the tax base. So anything that involves a building permit, anything that involves an electrical permit, anything that increases value to property. So the baseline for that is about 93,000. If nothing happens, just the usual background noises of kitchen renovations and new porch roof and maybe a garage or lick of paint on something or a pool put into a backyard, 93,000. So that's kind of your base. I'm putting in 142,000 because I think we have more commercial development than normal going on. So this is a number we can revisit later on as we get farther in towards town meeting, but 142 is about as high as I would push that number right now.
How come it's gone down 26%?
Because we had a lot of growth in the prior year having to do with solar in particular. Solar fields, I love them. Every time the sun shines, we make money. So we have some big solar projects coming on, so we may push that number back up to 190 or so. But trying to be a little conservative here, I certainly don't want to overshoot this particular number. The next number, 1,106,000, that is your debt exclusion, debt service that is the voters have authorized to put onto the tax rate. So this is the Hopkins Academy roof that we're still paying. This is half of the water treatment plant, which we're still paying on. It's a bunch of things. It works out to $1 million of debt service per year, which is about the lower limit of our safe debt service. We should have between 6% and 10% of our debt service, of our net revenue, go into debt service. So we're sort of like at the bottom end of that sweet zone between the optimal high and low. Anything lower, you're not keeping up with your capital effort. Anything higher becomes a burden on the taxpayer. So about $1,000,001 is 6%.
Are we expecting that to go way up because of the two buildings?
No, we have debt coming off, and so we've carefully structured this debt so that it should have an even impact upon the tax rate, and we'll continue visiting that. We threw in the library with that calculation as well. That hasn't been authorized yet, and we calculated debt service at 5%, which is well above what we've been getting with our market these days. So you add those numbers together, you come up with 11,660,000 and change. That is your first source of money, is the tax revenue. Table 2, state aid. This is sometimes called cherry sheet, so called because it used to be printed on pink paper. So It's money from the state. It's money for roads and bridges. It's money for education. It's reimbursement for charter school. It's reimbursements for veterans. It's payment in lieu of taxes for state-owned land. So these numbers are based upon the governor's numbers. These numbers will change six more times before we get a final budget out of the state. We'll have the House Ways and Means budget proposal. We'll have the House budget proposal. We'll have the Senate Ways and Means. We'll have the Senate proposal. We'll have the conference committee. And then we'll have the governor's budget. So sometime in July, these numbers will stop moving. So you'll hear from me from time to time by email saying, okay, new cherry sheet came out. This is the impact. And I'll give you all the ins and outs.
So chapter 70, what does that actually mean?
That's the commitment from the state to support our education.
Okay, so that's education.
Education.
And charter school reimbursement, we have a charter school.
Yep.
And someone gives us $80,000 because we have a charter school?
That's right, to make up for the fact that we are being hit by the assessment on charter schools. Let's see if I can find that number quickly.
$37,000
It's going to be something on the order of $400,000. So it costs us something like $400,000 to have charter school students. We get reimbursed $80,000. Not such a good deal.
Yeah, I'm just going to say that. So the town's paying for the charter school money that would normally go into our regular school? Or normal money that would be in our general fund?
So money, each student that goes from our public school system to a charter school, whether that be the Chinese or PVPA or some of the other ones around here, that money follows them. And so the charter school gets that money. We have to pay an assessment out. We are supposed to be reimbursed for that, but the formula is never fully funded, and that's the reason why you're seeing such a discrepancy.
Well, there's a big difference between never fully funded and 80 versus 400. That's like hardly at all funded.
Yep.
Okay.
So the charter school reimbursement, it stays in our general fund. It doesn't go directly to the school, correct?
It does not go to the school.
Okay, but only the school choice money goes to the school.
Only the school choice. And so if you look at that last line there, $451,000, that is an offset. That is, most of that will be money to the schools that the school committee gets to expend.
So this is incoming money from students who choice in?
Yep.
Right.
That's correct. Yep.
But when we...
And that goes directly to the school.
They get to spend it.
Right.
But let me get this straight now. When a student decides they want to go to a charter school, it doesn't come out of that, out of this money. It comes out of...
Yes.
Town money.
Yes. And if they choice out to another school district, same thing applies. So not so,
so it seems good. Like when money comes in, it goes to one place, but when it goes out, it goes to another place.
You're absolutely right.
Okay, so how did that happen?
That happened under ed reform back in 1999 or something like that.
So that's not a Hadley thing, that's a
state thing.
State thing.
And it works the same way with vocational schools. We don't have a vocational ed school in Hadley, so our students, through school choice, opt to go to Smith School or Franklin Tech, which the money is paid out for our students to go there.
And so how much, so just to get them knowledgeable, how much, do you know how much the school has in their school choice funds?
The last time I looked at it, it was something like $700,000, and I'm just grasping at that number. They had a sheet, which I have in a folder downstairs.
So they have that to use on top of their regular budgeted money, correct?
Okay, it just seems like it's not very much of a genius idea to, you know, what goes one way should go the other way.
I very much agree. It is a state thing.
So in other words, that's it. There's nothing you can do about it.
Nothing I can do about it. Senator Rosenberg and Representative Seibeck can. They
have to change the law, essentially.
They have to change the formula.
It won't happen.
All right, well, let's move on.
I'm sorry about that. So there's a gross there of $2,261,000. That has to be adjusted by the 451. That comes out in the next page when we talk about expenses. So there's... So my last comment about state aid is that it will change. I've seen it swing in a bad way at the very end after our town meeting, so I may be coming to you hat in hand in June saying, you know, they really clobbered us on school choice receiving or whatever. So that conference committee is always a time when I worry the most about this particular source of funding.
So beyond the last two actuals, how variable is state funding?
I've seen the assessment swing by as much as 25% from month to month, and that and from year to year. And that can be as much as $100,000. So it's something that I watch very closely. And unfortunately, the conference committee is what they call it, a conference committee, because they're working out the differences between the House budget proposal and the Senate budget proposal. There's equal numbers of senators and representatives in the room for the conference committee. It is closed door, not subject to open meeting law, so they do whatever horse trading they need to do in order to get to a budget that they present to the governor. So that's the time when this thing can move the most, and I will keep you informed about that.
Question on the pilot. That's the solar fields, right?
No.
Pretty much?
That is state-owned land, such as the university, that we receive the value of the taxes for undeveloped properties. So we get the tax payment on the land, not the buildings.
Oh. So that's that 202 there?
The 202, that's correct. The pilot for the solar, that gets into the new growth figure, which is that 142.
Oh.
It's a little confusing because there are three pilots in play here. Mm-hmm. And we'll encounter pilot again in our discussion. State tables.
Aid. Before you move off, can I say something about the state aid?
Sure.
Sheets? Okay. The way this is reported, revenues, the whole table two, state aid, cherry sheet is actually has two parts of it. One is the revenue section, which is these five or six categories of income that comes in. And then part two is the assessments against the town, the charges against to the town. So, and then the bottom line is the net. The way this is reported in here is the revenues are in one section and the expenditures are reported as part of the budget in another section.
Mm-hmm.
Realistically, the town benefits from the net of those two. So those are two figures in flux. You might see one go up and say, great, we've got an extra $30,000 over last year, but you have to look the other page and see if they didn't take it out from somewhere else. So
at the end of this book somewhere, there should be a bottom line?
You know what I'd like to do? we're always constantly figuring it. But how about I pull last year's cherry sheet, the final one, and get that to you so you see what those categories are for you, so you can recognize it for the future.
Thank you.
All right.
And again, my emails when new cherry sheets come out, we'll summarize all of this and say the net effect is plus, minus, same, whatever. Table three. All right, this is the local receipts. Almost $2.6 million. This is everything that we can do to raise money as a town government. So this is all the dog licenses, this is all the liquor licenses, this is the meals tax, this is the motel tax, this is the excise tax, this is pilot agreements that we've made with the town of Amherst. They have their wastewater treatment plant in the town of Hadley. They pay us some money. The Hadley Housing Authority, the state, pays us some money for that. Anything that we can do, investment earning, court fines, rental income, receipts from departments, any time that we can legitimately charge for a service, we will. And that's where all of this money comes in to this category.
So like police and fire, mm-hmm. are these like parking tickets and
parking tickets,
permits for burning?
Pistol permits, permits for burning, anything, records requests for accident reports, things like that. And the University of Massachusetts gives us a payment annually of $55,000, which is something that will be up for renegotiation.
And what are they paying? What services are we giving them?
We have two sports centers in the town of Hadley, so the Mullen Center and the McGurk Stadium are both there. So whenever they have events there, we have to get additional police officers out, additional firefighters that may be called to an event.
So the big stadiums are actually in Hadley property?
Yep. Yeah, a quarter of the UMass campus is in Hadley. So this is their payment to us to take into account some of the services that we provide for them.
So how does that work with the police when they come out of the stadium? They can't walk across the street because then they'll be in Amherst?
We have a mutual aid agreement, so yes, they can walk across the street. So,
sorry if I'm.
These are fine questions. And table four, okay, enterprise funds. These are water, sewer, and HPAT revenues that are used to support those without an impact upon the taxes. These are the water receipts. The water bills pay for the water system. Sewer bills pay for the sewer system, and Charter Communications pays for the cable for Hadley Media. There are some hidden costs for running water, sewer, and Hadley Media. So benefits, for example, all right, those are paid for through the general fund. Insurance, legal fees, my time, Linda's time, the collector's time, all of those things add up. And so in order to make sure that the people who are not on sewer, never going to get sewer, are not supporting through their property taxes, the sewer department, we do an administrative fee chargeback from each enterprise fund.
You're jiggling.
I'm sorry.
All right. So you may want to circle these three numbers. Mm-hmm. The second number in, 249502. The next one, 435485. And 8500, which has been negotiated down to 6200. Those are transfers from those enterprise funds into the general fund in order to avoid those hidden costs that are associated with running these enterprise funds. So they're chargebacks from water, sewer, and HPAT into the general fund to cover benefits, retirement, insurance, legal fees, my time, Linda's time, collectors, etc. All right, so they're trying not to have any hidden costs, but those are also revenues to the general fund. So when we total everything up, when you take the enterprise funds out, make sure you leave in those three administrative charges, because those go to the general fund and help balance the budget. Mm-hmm. That's it for revenues.
So it's kind of frightening. There's one page of input.
One in, and how many pages are going out?
Tones out.
So there is a narrative here that goes over a lot of this stuff here. It's in some perspective. If you turn over to page 37, these are the charges, the expenses. And I'm not going to walk through this because you're going to hear it over the course of the next few weeks. But I will say that there is the budget that is presented by the Finance Committee to the town meeting looks something like this. And Linda and I will work with you to prepare it. So it'll be your recommendations, but we'll put it in the format that's easy to understand, easy to read, and in actionable form for the town meeting. And we'll do that in plenty of time for everything to work as smoothly as we can. But it's broken into 9 series, 10 series actually, the 100 level series, it's general government, 200 is public safety, 300 is education, 400 is public works, then we have 440, 450, and 599 are the 3 enterprise funds, 500 is human services, 600 are the culture and recreation, 700 is debt, 800 are the state assessments, which is part of what you were talking about, Linda. And 900 is what we used to call this benefits. We've changed the name over to unclassified because it involves things other than benefits. So, but this is your retirement, your workers' comp, unemployment. But it's also got OPEB and transfers to stabilization in there, which are not technically benefits. So we'll prepare this based upon your votes and your guidance so that this is presentable for town meeting. As we go through the various budgets, these numbers will change. You heard a little bit about that last night. I'll be keeping a running tally of what's happening, and we'll take votes along the way or at the end as to...
So I have a question. When you budget for a number, say 50,000, and the actual only ends up being 40,000, the extra 10,000 that's not used goes into free cash.
Yes.
Correct? Now, on the enterprise funds, the ones that are not being used, doesn't go into free cash. Am I correct? Does that go back into the enterprise fund?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and when we say free cash, it sounds wonderful. It's basically, there's a technical definition, but the basic concept is leftover money at the end of the year, either because we didn't spend as much or we got more money and then we expected usually the combination, or there's a windfall. This money is not earmarked or claimed by anybody. That's the free part of it. It's free of earmarks. And it comes in the form of cash. It's not an IOU or a promissory note or a letter of credit.
And then I assume that takes care of any shortfalls that might have happened in other places?
Yes. So we're going to be using free cash in the fall town meeting in order to balance this budget. So we're going to pass a budget which is technically balanced at the May town meeting, and then we're going to come back in the fall and make the final adjustments based upon things that have happened at the end of the fiscal year that we didn't anticipate, such as the state aid going in a different direction, or our insurance money coming in a way that we didn't expect. We'll make those final adjustments at the fall town meeting.
But the goal is not to use free cash.
Right.
It's not good procedure to rely on that because that's money you're not aware of.
Right.
Well, I was going to say, what percentage of free cash typically gets reused?
We've used a lot of free cash in the past.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Just for curiosity purposes, when is the last time that, come June 30th, the budget balanced and you didn't rely on fall monies, free cash monies for the fall budget to budget the previous...
I'm sorry,
budget.
I'm not following.
So when is the last time the budget actually come June 30th or whatever?
We didn't have to go back and adjust it?
Yes.
Before the Great Recession, we almost made it 1 year. We were working towards reducing our reliance upon free cash as much as possible. I think we got it down to something on the order of $100,000 of free cash in order to balance the budget. That was in 2007, 2008 came along. Bottom fell out. We went back to relying heavily on free cash. We've been bringing it down. The select board adopted a policy to reduce our reliance upon free cash for recurring expenses within the budget. This is the first year of FY18 of implementing that new policy. So we're hoping that in a two-year period, we're down to zero free cash used for recurring expenses within the budget. That being said, there are things within your budget which are one-time purchases, or one-time purchases that you're making on the installment plan that you could use free cash for. So this is written out in exhaustive detail on page 21, if you want to make a note of that and review it over the next couple of days. So in general, we used about $157,000 of free cash for recurring expenses in this year's budget. We're trying to reduce that by $75,000 per year, so that so in 2 years' time, we're not using free cash for recurring. We almost made it in this budget. We're running a little hot there. I think I'm using $93,000 to balance the budget.
And you're estimating $500,000 typically?
Yeah, that's a safe average. It could be higher.
And so once you've closed out the year and there's free cash left over, what happens to that?
Gets certified by the Department of Revenue, becomes available for appropriation, and stays as free cash if you don't use it. July 1st of every year, it goes down to zero on the books, because it has to be recertified by Department of Revenue. So it's I've always thought of free cash as something that you should get into a form of into an account where it's stable and where it's protected from the ups and downs of year-end closeout. So if you have a lot of free cash, let's say that at the end of the year we have $100,000 or $200,000, don't keep it as free cash. Put it into a stabilization account, either the capital stabilization or the regular stabilization account, so that you've protected that money from being zeroed out because of a shortfall that you may experience in a grant or in tax collection or whatever.
So if it's in this now, quote unquote, safe account, is that then there forever? I mean, how does that? And so that's like a rainy day fund at some point?
It can be used as a rainy day fund, or it can be used for a special purpose. So the capital stabilization fund is used for capital purchases, trucks, buildings, infrastructure, feasibility studies associated with design, et cetera, engineering, things like that. The regular stabilization account, which has got about $2.1 million in it, that's used as a rainy day fund if we ever need it. That's when something really goes boom.
Yeah, you don't want to use it.
No.
Right, it's not even
really a lot if something boom big happened, like with the dam or something, right?
Yeah.
Originally, that stabilization account that you're talking about was started in 1982, and the first money was used to cut off the reservoir area, which added up to about $40,000. And that went in to start the stabilization. Since then, it's grown to a little over $2 million over the years.
Yeah.
But I have let's use an example, legal. If we have to budget enough in case we might need it, but if it was to go over, you can't bring that account negative. You would have
to
go into stabilization or something like that.
You have to fix it somehow.
Somehow. Now, there are accounts that you can go negative, right? And that would be
snow
like
and ice.
The snow and ice. Okay.
Right. But you still have to fix it.
Okay.
You can't.
Right, because you have to pay for
You have to
those
pay
things,
for it eventually.
Mm-hmm.
So either you let it roll into next year's tax rate, which is not a very good thing to do, or you take money from the various reserves. Some of those reserves are set up specifically for these purposes of taking into account unanticipated and extraordinary expenses.
Mm-hmm.
So you try to fill that gap with the reserve that's there for that purpose. So, for example, the Finance Committee controls a reserve of $50,000. So you can take money from that reserve, put it into an account that shows a deficit. Can also, at the last 2 months of the year, do line-to-line transfers within certain parameters.
And how are the stabilization accounts I guess, managed in terms of investment to at least combat inflation, or is that legal to do that?
Yeah, capital. It's invested differently than other town funds. There's different criteria for investing your trust funds and your capitalization funds. So we have our stabilization with Morgan Stanley, and they are in touch almost on a monthly basis about every CD that's rolling over and whether what we want to do with it. So that's and they keep track of our other investments and other accounts to make sure that we're staying within the appropriate limits of how much you can have in each bank and all that. So it's really, that's been worked very well for us. They also hold our CPA funds, which is another large account of. So they invest that, and that has different standards for investing than the stabilization. So these are watched really carefully. Fortunately, we have advisors on each of these accounts too, so it's not something that that I do on my own.
And then does it fall to a specific committee to review performance and kind of make decisions in that?
It has always just been with the treasurer. I generally pull David in when we have someone coming here to meet with me. I bring David in on it, and I've been very open and willing to have the finance committee be a part of it. It's probably not what you want to do right from the beginning because you're kind of busy right now. When we were almost at that point, weren't we, Karen?
Yes.
We're almost there. Going, okay, we're going to look a little bit more into the rest of it. I'm open to once you get through your budget and basic process, I'm very open to getting another level of input from the finance committee, and happy to discuss that at any time what you might want that to be.
Okay.
Also, on an individual basis, the books are open. Mm-hmm. Basically, if one of you wanted to come in and say, I want to see how we're doing, and I wonder if I might have some ideas, make an appointment with me, come on in, and I'd be happy to show it to you.
The vast majority of all of this is public record. So.
Thank you for your help. I do call her. Okay, so where were we here?
So, do you want to talk a little bit about the warrant? Or is there elements of the budget that we want to go over?
So, yeah, why don't we go over the warrant?
Also, I thought we should go over a little bit about, because there was a lot happening at the end of fall.
Mm-hmm.
with especially how the debt service is going to go and what your thoughts are. Linda's done quite a bit with that.
I have. When it comes to the budget, it's one revenue line and it's one expenditure line. It's what goes into that, which is, how much of it is principal and how much of it is interest. So I don't know how much time you want to take with
sure.
that.
But we had I just think that a couple of them didn't know that what we had happened in fall town meeting with so many purchases.
Right. There were a lot. We passed some large buildings and every capital item that was on there for trucks and buses and what else was that?
Yeah, so it's like $1.7 million
school.
Worth
yeah.
of equipment and projects, and then $2.6 million for the
$2.9 million
for the fire substation and $5.3 million for the senior center.
Right. We had worked. So our investment and our borrowing advisor that we use, Unibank, David Eisenthal is out here a few times a year to meet with Finance Select Board and explain how we're doing things. But he worked up for us before those votes at Fall Town Meeting a plan for borrowing. He had some options, and just to get to the bottom line, the Select Board and we all agreed that what we wanted to do was get the debt service payment each year to be even, that we would take an initial jump and tell people what that would be and what would be on their tax rate and have the borrowing sort of feathered in over a few years as we step up the borrowing for some of the items that have been voted on and balance it out against other items that are coming off that we have borrowed in previous years so that it would stay relatively stable over the next stretch of time and even allow for a third building if that gets voted in, if the library gets their grant and the town decides to fund the rest of that project, there would be, there's a place for that to get moved in about 3 years down the road as well. Mm-hmm. So I'd be happy to get that together for you. Yeah. I mean, we've done that a few times. We talked about that a little while ago, but just to, if
we have this in both table form and graphic form, so we should get that out to you so that you can see what it is that we're trying to do. You'll see the effects of, if we didn't vote anything, you'll see the debt falling precipitously, and you see the filling in of new debt so that there is this even an impact upon the tax rate.
And what was the figure that they had come up with if all three of the impact of each household, what it would be if all three?
Wasn't that the $95?
$95 per year.
Per household.
For the average family.
And that included all three of those new buildings?
At 5%.
At 5%. Do you, in your...
That would be that 95 is an increase over what the current level was.
Right.
Not a total.
Right.
Yeah.
No. Do you feel, in your opinion, do you feel like that's like pretty accurate?
Yes. Yes, and I think part of it is because we've been keeping the payments, we've been holding the levels of payoff up high so that rather than go for the minimal that we pay in a year, we've been bringing forward some principal payments and so that we can keep the total debt and interest at a higher level and allow for that rather than let it drop and then bring the money back up, the figure back up again. We have, we'll pay off, we'll use the planned debt and interest payment figure, mm-hmm. and if that's a drop year, we'll pay more principal to keep that up. The way it works is we have a debt and interest amount that we're going to pay in a year, and then that's applied to the tax rate. So the total amount, it's not so much for principal and so much for interest. So if we say $1.1 million in any given year, it would be a different makeup of principal and interest. And so what we're trying to do is push off some of the borrowing on anything that that a department hasn't bought by June 30th. We're not going to borrow it to be ready. They're going to wait until, or we're going to push what we can into the next fiscal year, so the borrowing, we start payments a year after we take a borrowing. So we want to borrow less, but pay off a higher amount of the principal in the next year, and then borrow some more. So it's kind of neat, actually. It's been fun. But once we have had the figure up there, we pay off principal, we put off borrowing, and hopefully keep an even payment schedule for the town and something predictable as you're working on the budgets. That will, if there are other capital items that will be coming up and being voted on, of course, that's going to be an additional amount.
Right.
So that's something to take up, you know, to consider as we go forward.
I have a question, David. So, you know, when you buy a house, you build a house, you say, oh, I have great plans and this is my plan, it's going to be $100,000. Well, it always ends up being more. It ends up being $150,000. So what happens with these buildings that we're building and they say they're at, you know, the $2.6 million and it ends up being $3 million? Where does that extra money come from?
So there are two things that will happen. You know, first of all, we have a bid process. So if the bids come in too high, then we have a decision whether we're going to raise the additional money or we're just going to change the scope of the work and rebid the project. That is probably more likely, is that we would change the scope of the project.
Mm-hmm.
If you're into it, and let's say that costs for some reason escalate and your contract doesn't cover you or protect you, which is very, you know, I can't think of how that would happen, but then you would have to go back and talk to the town meeting and raise the additional money.
So what you're saying is that they, whatever money you ask for in the bid is what it's going to be.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like my kitchen.
I'll be happy to share with you our construction contract. It is as thick as this book.
And that's okay. I have a book. Thank you.
Yeah, it has all sorts of protections in for the town.
Okay.
Has there ever been a time where, like, say it's $3 million, but it went under the $3 million?
Yes.
Right, and we like those times.
Yeah, because, yes.
Well, you know, when DPW or police, they're putting out how much do you need for your cruisers or how much do you need for a truck, they're always going to say enough to get it. So you might be putting in $50,000 for something and it ends up being bought for $46,000. That $4,000 we're not even going to borrow.
Right.
So that and that so that helps our projections each time that happens. We've had the town approved $150,000 for a backhoe, and it was great. They got $20,000 for the trade-in, so it was only $130,000.
Mm-hmm.
I say only, but it was $130,000. So we only borrowed $130,000 out of that, and that's $20,000 that then becomes available for something else. So that's another way that we're saving money. Those are a little different than the large projects you're talking about.
And then what you'll see on every town warrant is a cleanup article. You know, so we'll get down the road on a couple of projects, purchases. There's extra money left over. There's extra borrowing capacity. We'll go back to town and say we want to return the money to the pot that it came out of, or we want to reduce the bond borrowing authorization so we don't have excess borrowing cluttering up our accounts. So we'll touch upon that tonight a little bit.
A lot of that's dictated by the environment. Money coming in, working. If there's a lot of work out there, the bids could be higher. If there's no work out there, the bids could be lower.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on the environment of the economy, how it is. And that dictates what the bids may come in, higher or lower.
So how do you control the bid? So like we want a new senior center.
Mm-hmm.
And who specs out that building to put out for bid? Like, how does that get done?
That gets done. That gets reviewed by three groups. There's the architect that you've hired to do the schematics and the big bid, the bidding and the bid supervision. You have an owner's project manager, which is a position that's dictated by law that's overseeing the architect. And then you have a committee, building committee, that's overseeing all of those people. So that's how it gets put together. And the select board pulls the trigger on all of this. They're the signing authority for any of these projects.
Okay, so if some contractor comes in and they're 10% under bid, under anyone else,
mm-hmm.
who decides whether that's a good idea or not?
Well, assuming that the contractor meets all the requirements and that they're a reputable and responsible bidder, they would get the award. And it would be the select board who would assign that award.
Right, but so...
But they would be vetted by the committee, by the OPM, and by the architect.
I just want to make sure that you get the building you think you're going to get.
Yeah.
Right, that you don't go in there and it's made out of paper mache because you took the lowest bid.
Right.
Which is not necessarily a good idea.
This is where the two ad hoc committees came in initially, and a lot of man hours went into to come up with the initial price. You know, it's like 5.3 for the senior center and 2.9 for the fire station. That was done prior to the process we're in now. And hopefully we can get some good bids coming in. We may go under those prices. But then again, if the bids come in higher, we could be over those. But technically, the bids that were researched initially by those committee should cover both buildings.
Go ahead.
I was going to say those figures seem kind of light for a big building.
Does the senior center actually have plans?
They have an architect.
They do?
Yeah.
So are the plans, have they been generated yet, or is there something to look at?
They just got the architect, yes.
So really the $5.3 million that we voted on might not be enough, or they're going to try to, this architect's going to try to build what they want for that price?
So the architect's going to come back and say, here's what you can get for $5.3 million?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So when you went to town meeting, they actually voted on something that you didn't have a visual of.
And where did that $5.3 million number come from? How did that?
That was developed by the Municipal Building Committee. So they put together initial estimates for both the fire substation and the senior center.
Well, it seemed like that the fire station had quite a bit when they presented,
mm-hmm.
but the senior center, when I watched, it seemed like they presented to us the $3.5 million, and then they got it done again, and it went to $7 million, and then they did it again, and they just said, we'll take it in between. So
yeah.
I'm not sure who, where, which, It was confusing.
It was confusing.
It was at the last minute.
It was confusing. There was a lot of action going on at the last minute. I did review I just didn't have a whole lot of time, but I did review the numbers, and it looks like 5.6, 5.3 will give them a senior center.
Okay. I thought they just made it up.
No, they didn't.
It's not going to be the 7.1 senior center that they wanted initially.
Okay.
It's curtailed way back now.
Well, they originally thought this, they said this is how big it's going to be, gave us the numbers, and then they said it was going to be 3.5.
Right. When they first came to us, that was what they
said.
And
then it was said, well, wait a minute, this doesn't look right. And then it ended up being 7.
Now, didn't the fire station have its own committee that worked on that, not
yes.
the municipal building committee?
The municipal building committee is supposed to be overseeing all these projects.
Right, but there was somebody from that committee on that, right?
Liaisons of the municipal
mm-hmm.
building committee are in both the senior center building committee and the fire substation building committee. So there is coordination and communication going on there.
Great.
Well, now that we said it's 5.3, that's what they have to stick to anyways, at this point.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right, or
okay.
Come back and ask for more.
Okay.
And what sort of square footage does one get for 5.3?
13,000 square feet, was it? I think that includes...
Is that all on one floor?
The one floor, and that includes the mechanical rooms.
They've changed. They're planning a basement in it now.
That's new information.
Yeah, that's the last I heard when they had it.
Are they going to have room for Park and Rec to go in there?
Meeting when they had the architect.
Okay.
Are they going to have
I'll
room
check
for...
On that one.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Is this building... Could we put Park and Rec in this building as well?
The select board owns the buildings, so they can make any decision they wish.
Okay. I understand that, but was it like... So what's going to happen to... Park and Rec. Park and Rec is now in that building, and so if the library wants to move into that building, once seniors move out, where's Park and Rec going?
Park and Rec can come here. We've got a dandy office right on the other side of that wall.
Oh, okay.
And also school we still have.
Yeah.
We'll have an open school next door.
Yeah.
Well, I just thought it would be interesting to see them with the senior center because, me personally, I think that they could share a lot of the services together,
mm-hmm.
and that would save funds there as well.
How about the senior and junior center?
No, but you have people in each department doing the same job.
Yeah.
And if you share services, which is savings all around, there's not... Park and Rec needs a couple offices, but the kids aren't there with the seniors. Their programs are spread out through the Chinese Immersion School, the elementary school, the fields, and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So how can I be helpful to you right now? It sounds like you want to have a conversation with the two building committees.
Well, I think down the line that would be... useful so everybody can understand actually.
Well, that was a big deal that happened last fall. It's going to affect us quite a bit.
Yeah. So I think there's...
So the other thing is when on the warrant, how will these even come to happen is there was a petition. So how it started was the library has a grant that will pay for half of the library. They applied for the grant,
applications in.
They
yep.
applied for the grant. But the only thing is they had to do it in where the senior center is. That was the space that they wanted. Well, that means the senior center has to move. So the senior center will move. But this was all done by petition putting the senior center where it is now. One of the questions comes up often is in saving money is how does it come about where they could share, like you said?
Mm-hmm.
There could be shares. Is it the select board at some point that could say, well, we can just make this big building a community center and let everybody share it? So you don't have to plow several places and you don't have to keep doing, so it seems like just because it went on petition and it went on to the warrant, who, you know...
Does the select board have any control over actually...
Yes, they do. They're the ones who can... They own the buildings, they own the design ultimately, they own the project.
Right, so...
They're responsible ultimately for that. They get to say at the end of the day how this building is going to be handled and what's going to go.
So they could build one big building and say the library is upstairs and the senior center is downstairs, or...
Yeah. Do they have the right to say that?
It's their building.
Okay, so the person bringing the petition only has the right to, you know, the people bringing the petition is to bring it to town meeting. So actually, should the select board have done, if they their thoughts on that were to combine a building, should it have been done before the petition actually went to town vote? How does that work? Or is it done afterwards?
Well, you're the selectman.
You've been on all along with the building needs committee. What you're talking about, they proposed a campus center, but it didn't come to fruition. When you're talking about the library, the reason why it's cited there, the property has to be on a main road, and Middle Street is the main road. And so that's why they're designating that area. That's criteria for the grant.
Right.
So there's all kinds of, you know, different things that come into grants and play, and but the building needs committee has been the one that's been basically in charge in getting these buildings off the ground.
Okay, so why with the old? So we're in the same situation with the old buildings too. So we get the new buildings, and then we have the buildings that are now going to be vacant, and they're going to run into the same problem as North Hadley Hall, right? So has the select board thought about fundings for that? To maintaining them, to do something with them?
We put North Hadley Hall on hold
Not
until the fire station gets built. And the same thing, the building needs committee is looking at Russell School for the future, if it can be used by the town. But the biggest problem is the prevailing wage, trying to fix these old buildings up. You have to pay the prevailing wage if the town does it. And it's just too cost prohibitive to revamp these buildings. It's millions, and
so it's cheaper,
school would be $9 million.
So it's cheaper to build a new building than to...
You just hit the nail right on the head.
Exactly.
Yes,
exactly.
But you still have to deal with the old buildings.
And you still have to deal with the budget, the paying for the maintenance of
right,
the building.
The maintenance of the buildings.
And the old ones and
well, because I noticed that in one of the evenings that the North Hadley Hall was sort of reduced to nothing in cost, or very little in cost. So it's just like you closed the door and walked away?
I'm not going to heat a building that's not being used.
Well, yes, but the fastest way to have a building fall completely to bits is to not heat it.
Right.
Right.
The fire station has its own separate heating system and everything. It's a separate entity from the hall.
Right. So you didn't answer my question.
Well, there's a number of questions on here. I'm not sure I can
How does
answer.
That work?
Okay, so how does it work? Okay, so a little bit of history. So last night, the select board awarded the contracts for the design for the senior center and for the fire substation. So those contracts were sent out today. So the companies have to sign them. There's going to be an orientation meeting at which the selectmen are going to be invited. And I think it's up to the select board. And every week this comes back to the select board for a check-in. It's up to the select board to decide ultimately what are the broad contours of each building, what do they want to see in there. If they want to have a standalone senior center, then that's what the select board are going to decide. The design will be, if they want to combine senior center with a number of other functions, then that's what the design is going to be. But it's ultimately up to the select board to make that decision.
So the answer to my question was, is they make that decision after the petition goes to town meeting for a vote?
Yeah, so the petition is only for the right for the article to appear on the warrant.
Right. And so then after the fact, they can say, okay, well, we're going to just do one building and not two separate buildings, if they chose to.
The select board could choose not to borrow any of the money.
Okay.
Okay, these These articles are instructions or authorizations that do not compel action.
Okay.
I guess the answer to that, these two buildings now are being, they're in the schematic design phase, and they're designing them for the wishes of Council on Aging and basically the fire department. There's not going to be other any other departments in those buildings at this point.
Yeah, I was thinking not the fire department, but the senior center and the library.
Not the way it's designed right now. It's only going to be the senior center.
So if somebody wanted to put a petition together to see those offices or those entities in one building and bring it to town meeting, they just need 100 or whatever, how many signatures to do that?
It's too late, I guess. That's my answer to you.
Okay.
Because they're doing the design phase, the schematics. It's not going to include anything else.
Well, I just want, if people are asking me,
it's in the process.
I just want to have an answer if people are asking me, well, why can't they share a building, and maybe it would save on the taxpayers who have limited funds
so
to pay their taxes.
This is a conversation you want to have with the select board.
Okay.
All right. That's,
and that conversation was had at the building needs committee initially on, and it didn't go that route. Remember, there was talk about purchasing the land of a cool and buys land and making a community type area there, buildings, but it didn't come to fruition. And what we have before us now is reality.
Okay, thank you.
So I think at this point, we just have, this is what is given, and we just have to figure out how to pay for it, or how to move the numbers around, get things to budget, correct?
For the borrowing?
For borrowing, or not necessarily borrowing, but putting the
budget.
The budget together.
Right.
We're, yeah.
You know, fortunately, years ago, you can thank David for that 150-page document, and so can the Board of Selectmen. It was the Finance Committee years ago to create that document, and can you imagine the time that went into that?
Oh, absolutely.
Before you had three selectmen and secretary, basically, right? And you did it, and I did it, and that was created.
We did the budget on our home committee.
Now it's a different process. David creates the initial budget, sitting down with all the department heads for the Board of Selectmen. Now we're in the process of going through the second phase of it for cutting and things of that nature. But the process is taking a lot away from the Finance Committee the way it's done today. You know, but now it's going to be your turn. You have the book to go through it and see if everything's up to snuff in there for you people.
Okay.
So it would be helpful if we went through the warrant?
Sure. Yes.
Okay. There's some slam dunks in here. You can take your votes tonight if you wish, or we can wait till a different time. Just in general, Finance Committee has the authority to make a recommendation on any matter on the warrant that has a financial impact. Some Finance Committees see that role as being a narrow one, that you make a recommendation on the appropriation articles and the things having to do with zoning or non-binding referendums you're not so much concerned about. Other Finance Committees see their role as being more expansive, and basically everything that's on a warrant has some sort of financial impact somewhere down the line, and so they make a recommendation on all of the articles. I'll leave that decision up to you. I'm not here to tell you what you should recommend and what you shouldn't. I have written in some places where typically Finance Committees do make a recommendation. Again, this is just me making a note. You're not bound by that at all. All right. So just very quickly, I'm going to breeze through these things. The first three articles are slam dunks, and I recommend that you approve them. Article 1 allows us to apply for and expend grants and gifts so that we don't have to go back to town meeting every time we get a $1,500 grant. So this just allows us to expend grant monies without appropriation from town meeting. So this is standard, always number one article. Number two is a article that allows us to receive and expend Chapter 90 money. This is money from the state for roads and bridges. So we typically get $350,000 or better per year. It looks like we're going to get about $370,000 for FY18. Article 3 is short-term borrowing. Should we ever have a cash management problem, that is just temporary, and when I say temporary, just a couple of months, and we know that we have receipts coming in that the treasurer, with the authority of the selectmen, can borrow for in anticipation for those receipts coming in and covering that cost. So those first three are housekeeping articles. They're always on the annual town meeting warrant in that order. And
did you want us to vote on it now?
Whenever you're ready to vote on it, but I think these three are slam dunks.
Yeah.
Can we make a motion to vote on all three articles at the same time?
Mm-hmm. Second.
Okay, good.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Progress.
So I have a question on the voting real quick.
Sure.
There's five of us, but there's only four of us.
Right.
Should we split 50-50? And then what happens?
Then the vote, the motion fails.
Okay.
Let me just back up a little bit. Okay, so each article has an article number. It also has an explanation. When we go to town meeting, we're going to be presenting motions based upon the articles. I will be providing for you a master sheet that has the article, the motion, and the talking points associated with each one of those. And you should get that at least a week in advance so that you have a fine-grained analysis of what's going on. Article 4, this is the revolving fund article. We have to vote this every year. At the annual town meeting, I gave a discussion about that last night. There's no change from this year to FY18. This is a way for us to pay for services using user fees or other sources of money, so it doesn't have to be on the tax rate or a burden to the taxpayers.
These aren't funded, correct?
Yeah, these are not funded. These establish authorizations on how much you can spend out of each revolving fund, and if there's any surplus left at the end of the fiscal year, how big can that surplus be? Because we don't want money pooling up and being unproductive, so it has to be scooped back into the...
So these caps mean anything over $2,000 would then flow back somewhere else?
Absolutely, go back to free cash.
Okay.
Article 5. Now, this is a work in progress, but this is what we were talking about. This is a cleanup article, and we're still working on the fine-grained analysis for this, so we'll present to you later on a cleanup Article 5. But basically, if we've got money left over that's unproductive, we want to return it to the pot that it goes to. If we have small borrowings that are still on the book, we want to clean all of that up. And that's what this article does. So this is another housekeeping article. Article 6 is the omnibus budget. That's this thing right here. Okay.
So short.
It's the bus size.
All right. So this is how the article will appear on the warrant. The motion itself will be very complicated, and again, I'll be providing you with all of that information. Article 7.
David, yes. Have a format for the budget. I assume we're going to follow, mm-hmm, Terry, the same as we had done before.
Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then what I'll do is send each of you a copy of last year's too. And if you want me, I can actually make the changes and give you a blank column for the new one. Mm-hmm. Set it up. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that now this is a handout for each department. We have these salaries and expenses are voted separately, and because they're often worked on very close to town meeting, yes, this is the one that is on the warrant, very short past the budget, but this is a handout which goes to people as they walk in at town meeting. Hopefully, it's posted online and available for handout well before town meeting, or hopefully at that. There's a warrant.
There's going to be a presentation.
Presentation. Yeah. So this is what, this will be the product of your recommendations. This is the recommended Finance Committee budget, which is hopefully something that's worked on with the select board, so mm-hmm. that you're presenting it. So I'll set it up for you.
And normally you wouldn't vote the whole budget. They normally take, what, 10?
We stand
10
up,
at a
yeah,
time
we break it up.
For discussion, and then if there's none, it's passed, and then continue on with the next 10.
Yeah, we each take a turn and stand up and read them. So.
Article 7, okay, this is...
We get to reverse first.
Yeah.
That's what Amy said last
Article
year.
7, okay, so this is a standard article that we have. We have a water filtration plant. That water filtration plant has membranes in it that filter water down to the level of a virus. Okay, so all of your water that you're getting is being taken out of the Callahan well, goes through these membranes, it gets treated with, and then it goes out into the water system. These membranes last for about 10 years. Okay, costs about $260,000 to replace them. So we set aside from water reserves $26,000 per year for 10 years, so that at the end of the use life of these membranes, we have money there that we need, that we can use in order to do this.
And the price over 10 years doesn't change?
It does change, but this is our best estimate right now. This will be the first year of a second series of doing this. So we've just replaced the water filters this past season. So they're brand spanking new, right out of the box. They'll last for another 10 years. We think it's going to cost $260,000. As we get closer to the end of its life, we'll obviously be changing those numbers in order to reflect the realities.
What did they cost us past time?
They cost us, we got a steep discount. It cost us about $150,000.
That's good.
So
what's all the brown material that's in our water if these filters are so good?
Two things. If they're doing unidirectional flushing, so there may be some sediment from the inside of the pipes that's being kicked up. So that would be after treatment flushing that would be affecting the water. There might be a water break, and so that sometimes will get some turbidity going. Or there may be some sort of imperfection with the manganese control, which would turn things brown. So I'll talk to the water department tomorrow and say you're reporting brown water.
I can bring our filters in.
Okay.
They yeah. want.
Okay.
I mean, it's not brown as you see it in like a glass of water,
mm-hmm.
but I filter all the water that comes into my house, and
yeah.
those filters, I mean, they come out pretty nasty.
Probably it's from the 100-year-old pipe. So that's probably what it is.
David?
Yeah.
Is this a stabilization fund? Is that same as the other, so that when they actually spend the money out, it has to go to town meeting again for spending the money?
Yes,
it?
Yes,
okay.
It does.
So this is just putting the money in?
Just putting the money in with a majority vote, and then it comes out with a 2/3 majority vote. Article 8, okay, so this is the capital article. I would like to have the capital article be in the fall, you know, so we do the omnibus budget during the springtime and capital projects in the fall. But there are a couple that don't seem to want to wait. There's an opportunity for us to address the town hall parking lot paving for $25,000. And I may have money from another account, so that expense may go away. From this, so I'm still working on this. And then the other is HadleyMedia has about $69,000 of capital money that they need to access in order to modernize. So we would bring this, we would appropriate $69,000 or $70,000 from their funds so that they can continue the project of updating Hadley Media. Neither of these will have an impact upon taxes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The other two are projects from the Municipal Building Committee, and I don't know very much about them. I'll be meeting with them in a week or so in order to tighten this one up. So this is still a work in progress. Article 9, I talked about this last night. The Municipal Modernization Act gives us lots of opportunities. I intend to mine that thing until next town meeting, so this will give us an opportunity to authorize the use of paid consultants to review technical plans so that we can free up staff time so they can do the functions that we pay them for. Mm-hmm. Article 10, Long Range Plan Implementation Committee. Again, I talked about this last night. This is a committee that did a lot of good work in the past, but is not active anymore. It was formed by town meeting votes, so it has to be laid down by town meeting vote.
I like Article 11 there.
Article 11.
Wait, before we get to Article 11.
Sorry.
So this,
I just got my eye there.
At some point, October 27, 2005, somebody thought this was a good idea to have this committee.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened since then that it's no longer a good idea to have this committee?
So at the same time as this committee was formed, we also adopted the 2005 master plan. Master plans are good for 10 years. The planning board is updating the master plan. And by statute, they're legally responsible for its implementation. So we had an implementation committee that worked on a master plan, and they did good work. That master plan is now no longer valid, or that's not the right word, no longer recognized as being a valid master plan. Updating it, and the planning board has control of that.
So it just moved over to the planning board?
Yeah.
The function of this moved over to the planning board.
Yeah, it always was with them before. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that created some confusion as to who was authorized to implement the 2005 master plan. Article 11, Senior Tax Work-Off Program. This is something that we've talked about for a while, sort of by fits and starts, and I said this year we're going to try it. So this is something that many surrounding communities do. It's a complicated proposal. There are a lot of things to review, so we need to take a little bit of time on it. The Select Board will be digging into this at their next meeting on the 15th.
That's an excellent idea. Northampton does it.
Amherst does it. Northampton does it. I think Sunderland does it.
Can you just give us the technical version?
So this may be, I'm trying to set this up as a win-win. We're understaffed. We don't have bench strength for many of these departments around here. But we're hesitant to add staff because that adds to our unfunded liabilities having to do with pension and health care and LPIB and all that kind of stuff. So we're kind of stuck. We need people. We don't want people. This may be a win-win situation where we can use the talent and expertise of the senior population on a temporary basis to help out with some of our functions, and they get in return not money, but they get a break in their taxes. And we can set the parameters up for that. We can say no more than 10 seniors per year, and the tax break can be $1,000 per year. So that's a cost to the town of $10,000, but you're getting 10 people working for 90 hours in the year in order to help out various functions, whether that be library, senior center, light duty here, expertise with whatever it is that they have talent in. So
it works out to be minimum wage pay?
So Massachusetts minimum wage would be the minimum that they would get. So right now I think that's $11 per hour.
I think that's excellent. And it will help the people that can't afford the tax increase.
You want to?
I'll take 2 years. Awesome.
I feel bad that we're divvying up old people.
It's 16 and over.
Believe it or not, those people are probably very happy.
Have something to do, right?
Right, to utilize their brain cells there.
All right, right. That sounds good.
Article 12 and Article 13 are the two solar pilot agreements, and those agreements we just got in, and we'll be taking a look at them, but it looks like a win-win. Talked a little bit about it last night. They're set up so that the Hadley taxpayers gets more taxes over a 10-year period than regular taxation would bring in, and the solar developer gets to control their cash flow, so that makes it more feasible for them to do the development. This is a 5-megawatt facility that's going in 2 parcels. So we'll use Article 12 for the first one and the Article 13 for the second one.
And wait, so who gets the electricity that comes from these?
This is sold out, so anybody who wants to subscribe, so residents can subscribe to this. Typically, they try to find big energy users, say the University of Massachusetts, to take the load from them or part of the load. The first solar development that went in that we did a pilot agreement with, we ended up taking about half the load. So that powers 5 of our facilities, the public safety complex, the 2 schools, and the 2 treatment plants, which accounts for about 70% of our total electric use, which we use about $250,000 per year of electricity. So 70% of that is now solar associated, and we get a 21% discount on that energy use. So we get a lot of savings. We're on track to between $300,000 and $600,000 of savings for just that project.
So we get a break on our electric bill. It's not like we don't get 75% off of our electric bill.
No, we get 21% off of our electric bill for those 5 facilities. So.
And so the owner, so we get some tax revenue for the land that they're sitting their panels on.
We get taxed on the land. We get the panel taxes, taxed under personal property.
Okay, so it's like a car or a boat or something.
Yeah, a car and a boat or cash register.
And we get a break on the electricity. And the only downside is that there's now a field that has all these solar panels on it that can't be used for anything else.
Right.
Is it worked in that we have the first rights to purchase the electricity, or is that just up to the developer's discretion?
It's not worked into that. We made a deal with Nexam for the first solar development. We're trying to get the second solar development to give us the tax credits, the energy credits. There, we're almost clinched that deal. So that would mean the remaining 30% of us, of our electricity, would receive, I think it's a 17% discount under SREC 2. So. And then we'll be maxed out. We can't use any more electricity. So.
And residents can also sign up to?
Yes. Yes.
And where would they do that?
They would contact Nexamp for this particular project. There are other developers. There's Scatter Solar. That's the Huntington Road one. Hampshire College has got a solar array in our town that powers part of their campus. UMass similarly has a solar array that's in our town, for which we receive money on non-taxed land now. So that's where people go. The buyers beware. You should deal with reputable companies. There are a lot of snake oil salesmen out there on this.
We hold cleanup funds. He asked about the downside being a field full of solar panels. Mm-hmm. But at the beginning of the project, an amount is paid over, and we have a couple of agency funds that we hold, and they will get their deposit back at the end, of assuming that they clean up. Otherwise, we get to use the money. It's like a landlord's
security deposit.
And they're responsible for mowing and keeping the thing clean and all that.
Yep. And security and all that kind of stuff. So.
Can I ask Donald Pichisky a question? So you had an objection to the solar panels.
I just don't like them going on the farmland, but there's nothing we can do about it, you know? So that was just the point I made, you know?
It's entirely up, well, if the owner wants them there, right? And then yeah. The company comes to you, yeah. I mean, you really can't say much about
well,
it,
but
can
if,
you?
If a property is, I mean, are properties zoned as farmland or not farmland?
Right, so these things are allowed in the industrial district. Okay, so wherever we have a zoning designation of industrial, that's where the solar fields are allowed to go, unless they get a special exemption from planning board or zoning board of appeals, like the Huntington Road one.
And say a farmer in town who owns some property and they've had it up to here with farming, can they just put up solar panels?
They can go through the permits and do that, yeah.
Yeah, Wayne Goulet did that, didn't he?
Yeah.
Well, I thought some of it was in farm banks.
The one near the Silvio Conti, but now they're looking at a Crystal Trust property probably to move it there. So.
Can anybody get them on their house?
I can't put solar panels on my house because my house is facing the wrong direction and it's got a slate roof, so I'm out of the game. But I could. but people like me could invest in a solar panel in Hadley and receive the benefit.
Nick, I mean, people call about that all the time.
Yeah.
And I would probably do it, except my wife thinks they're ugly. So that ended that discussion, right?
Probably the best way to go is call MassSafe. And they provide you with all the information. You can get zero interest loans from them and things of that sort if you're interested in doing them.
I told you, my wife thinks they're ugly.
No, they probably are.
So, but I thought a lot of the farmland around here is protected.
Yes, so protected farmland would not be eligible for that kind of development.
So how does that work? Because that means some farmland is worth more than other farmland.
Yes, there's a complicated formula for determining the value of farmland, including the type of soils, location, type of crops that are used on that. So if you grow corn, that's one value. If you grow alfalfa, it's another value.
So it changes from year to year if they change what the crop is?
It can.
You're very knowledgeable of all this.
But if it's dictated where the land is, if it's along a major roadway, then you have accessible building lots. So that pushes up the property value a great deal. And then it depends on the consistency of the land. If it's wet and not buildable, it's not worth as much money.
Some land is protected under chapter, so they receive a discount on their taxes based upon whether they've put it in a chapter or designation, which they have to renew annually. If they fail to do that, then they have to pay a 5-year rollback tax, the difference between the discount and the property value.
Are there more? Sorry, I didn't mean to go off on the tangent, but...
Article 14, I'm not sure whether this is the right time for this, but the Hadley voters voted in favor of recreational marijuana, 54% in favor and 46% opposed. The law allows for local option tax. Law specifies 2% right now, but I think that may be changed.
2%, that's it?
Yes.
So right. We get this if there's a dispensary in Hadley?
Any sales of recreational marijuana could be subject to a local tax of 2%. As the law.
So when do you like foresee when that might happen?
Yes. So if we go on to Article 24 on page 18,
mm-hmm.
You see that I'm recommending that we have a moratorium of 1 year on the sale of recreational marijuana for lots of reasons. One of which is the law is really written so that there's a lot of questions associated with it. You can interpret it many different ways, and so there's a lot of uncertainty with it.
Mm-hmm.
the regulations, if you turn to page 19, I've provided a timeline. The regulations won't be ready until March 1st, 2018. So we don't even know how to regulate this until this time next year. So I'm recommending that we put a moratorium, a zoning moratorium on the sale of recreational marijuana in order to give us an opportunity to understand what it is that's being proposed, because this thing is going to go through a number of changes at the state level.
On the other hand, we live in the middle of five universities.
Yes.
There's a lot of 2% there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but then...
Well, and you...
You're going to... I think it's going to increase our expenses for our police department when everybody's driving up Room 9 highs.
Right. But it's going to anyway. So you might as well... But it's going to anyway.
Right.
So you might as well collect the 2%.
Mm-hmm. Right, but I'm thinking our expenses are going to be much higher in other ways than we'll end up losing money.
If the expenses are unavoidable, then you should take the opportunity to raise the revenues.
Oh, I agree.
Yeah.
So I'm just saying
we should raise enough.
I'm sorry?
What's the discussion in surrounding communities? Are they going to adopt a similar kind of moratorium? Because if we have dispensaries in Amherst and Northampton mm-hmm. right next to us, we're still going to be seeing the same problems on Route 9, but mm-hmm. we're not
going to see the revenue unless we wait and the other towns scoop us.
Right. And that's a real danger because with the medical marijuana, when we first got the news that we'd be getting a dispensary here, I reached out to the surrounding communities and said, how about a community impact statement, agreement, what have you done? And it turns out nobody had thought of it. So the industry was in a position of playing the towns off against each other. Mm. East Hampton, Northampton, South Hadley, Amherst, none of them been thinking about it. So we got a bunch of people together, some of the town administrators, and said, okay, so what models are out there and what can we do to be in concert so that all of us are saying, not so fast, you have to enter into a community impact agreement. So Amherst started developing theirs. We have one. We signed one with the dispensary down the street, which is still yet to be built. We shared that with the small town administrators network, as well as the managers network. So we recognize that we could be in a position where we're being bargained against each other. And communication and coordination with the town managers around here and mayors is essential to make this work for all of our interests.
And so the thoughts we could use that framework from the medicinal marijuana and carry that forward to the recreational?
Yep. Gotcha. If the law allows, which it currently doesn't, so.
Well, I think we should definitely be ready for it.
Yes.
You don't want Amherst and Northampton to be selling all this weed and we have to deal with the people driving back and forth in between and whatever else happens.
No, we need our Hadley grass.
Eat our Hadley grass, exactly.
Asparagus, that's right.
So that's up to the planning board to decide whether we're going to do the...
It's okay. It's just like alcohol. You can tax the shit out of it.
I'm okay with it.
All right, I think that brings us up to...
Well, wait, we skipped over a whole bunch.
Yeah. Okay, Article 15. This is a standard article. It's on the consent agenda every year. This is the Community Preservation Act. They're required each year to set aside a certain amount of their funds for three purposes: open space preservation, historic preservation, and housing. So the $30,000 that's being proposed for each of those categories exceeds the minimum requirement there. There's no impact upon taxes for this particular article. In addition, they raised $15,000 money for dollars for their own expenses, and they're going through a mandated spending plan that drove that number up. It used to be $5,000. Went up to $10,000 and now it's $15,000. But again, there's no impact on taxes on this.
Does that roll back at the end of each year?
Yes. The 15,000, not the 30,000.
Right, the 15, yes. Yeah, that's what I thought, because they, yeah.
16, okay, 16, 17, 18, 19 are CPA articles.
I have a question.
Sure.
Is there a final dollar amount on the Satirka Park that it's actually going to cost to have a completed park, what they want to do there?
I don't know, because they went to the planning board the other night, and the planning board had a problem with the amphitheater, so... That may be, that design may go away, so I don't know what the expense for that is. I was talking to Kathy Zaterka this afternoon about that, so it looks like they're going back to the drawing board on that.
So do they have a set of, I don't know that I ever saw a whole like set of plan of what they want to do there. Is it like posted over there?
Yeah, if you talk to Kathy, I think she can provide you with all that information.
Yeah, I was just curious. I mean, I'm all for it and stuff, but I'm just wondering, you know, what is it going to cost?
I know that they ran into a significant design change, so I don't know what the cost is right now.
And what about the George Edwards Fund? Can they access that?
Yep.
How much is in there?
We were just looking at those numbers this very morning.
Right. Well, some of the money is appropriated for this project out of it. It was was a condition, I think, of the CPA funding, is that $20,000 be used out of that. Was it like 70, 80?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Do people have to vote to use that money?
Yes.
Yes.
The George Edwards?
Absolutely.
So is that an article here?
No.
Or did we already vote on it? Or?
Yes.
We did?
You already voted that one.
Yeah.
When was that?
$20,000 came out, I think, in the fall.
Yeah.
I think that's it. I may not be remembering.
Now, the other thing, if I could just, on this, on some of the CPA, Article 16, 17, and 18, they haven't been actually voted upon through
that's
the CPA. So if the CPA votes not to recommend them, then will they come off the article?
By law, they have to come off. Okay. So if they only appear on the warrant if the CPA committee approves.
Wait, can CPA committee?
Community Preservation Act.
I have a question. So I noticed that Northampton is asking for funds from Hadley and area towns, and I understand that. But has Hadley, for like this building or any of these other buildings, are they able to go to CPA and say, oh, we want to borrow money to upkeep on or do something to one of these buildings?
I went some years ago. I went to CPA with the historic preservation plan, which outlined $1.7 million worth of renovations to the historic buildings. That'd be North Hadley Village Hall, the Russell School, and the Town Hall. That request for funds was not granted.
So we have a new board there now. Have you tried it again or thought about trying it again? I mean, plus you're not doing anything with North Hadley Hall.
Give it another go.
Please.
Well, plus you don't have to include North Hadley Hall now with that.
Now I can spend it all in Russell School if I wish.
The one thing I found that I've been kind of disappointed with is, yes, it's to like replace or to, you know, if it's a historic building. But my understanding is at one point, I think it was the front door that you wanted to put in, but because it wasn't the right material, that it wasn't, you couldn't use the CPA funds?
Well, that's one of the cleanup articles, actually. It's not in this, but one of the items on the cleanup article for getting money back is there was $23,000 on an earlier article voted for the town hall windows and doors. And ultimately, it was paid for from another source when other work was being done in the building, and the whole $23,000 is going back to CPA because of
they
of
weren't
that.
They didn't weren't approved type of material.
Well, why does that matter? Like, I mean, a window's a window. No,
it's historical.
We try to get CPA money for the North Hadley Fire Station because it has to look historical to fit in the historical district. But you can't take even a penny for new construction.
No.
So my thought process is yeah, I'd love to help Northampton, but why can't we help our own buildings with some funds?
Well, I guess the answer to that is the courthouse is owned by all the towns in Hampshire County. So we own the courthouse in essence.
I understand,
and so that's why they're looking for funds to repair it. The COG does not own the courthouse. The towns own the, even though Northampton and Amherst aren't part of the COG, they still own the courthouse.
So it's like a joint ownership of all those?
All the municipalities
that use the courthouse. Yeah.
Own the courthouse.
But I think a lot of people feel the same way. You know, we should put back, we should give back to Hadley first. We haven't even seen, you know, we see these buildings that could use a little bit of TLC. We'd like to give it back to Hadley before we give it out to someone else.
So, and my question to you is just quickly, because I know it's getting late. When you worked on it before, was it just you that came up with the whole plan and presented it? Did you have support?
The
don't fall backwards.
I know if you died, that would be awful.
Don't end up in the hospital yet. Sit down.
CPA asked that we do a historic preservation plan, so we spent money on putting together a historic preservation plan. That historic preservation plan identified a whole bunch of work that needed to be done. I went to CPA with the plan, with the request for the funding. It didn't get funded, didn't get the nod. So I will be happy to return and say, you know, here's the plan along with these other plans that we've developed in the meantime. Here's a funding strategy. This is what how it's going to work.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see if CPA gives us the nod or not.
We'd love to see.
Is it a one and done process, or is it iterative where they give you recommendations and you can, within a brief time frame, like get back to them? It just seems odd that they would request that and then reject it and then not.
Well, I think you have a new board and a new outlook on things. I think that, you know, a few years back when you were presenting this, that things were looked at differently. So I think the people at on the board, I'm not criticizing anybody else, they're more open-minded about doing things and sharing the wealth.
Now, I know the school is coming to the CPA for their fields. They were granted at the town or the fall meeting money from CPA to come together with a plan. And so I'm expecting them they're not ready yet, but they probably will come soon. And that's probably about $500,000.
So to answer your question directly, at the time, the CPA tended to meet and receive the various proposals. I'm encouraged that the CPA is now looking at a spending plan so that we can approach them, because they're being a little bit more proactive about this, so we can get that process you just described going, so that if we present something, the feedback is not a toggle switch of either we love it or no.
Right.
That, you know, can you change it this way? And we can I'm happy to work with them. Do you have a meeting scheduled yet?
Yes, I believe it's the 27th.
27th, okay. That's grand. I'm just going to very briefly walk through the CPA articles, because, again, if they don't agree to it, then it's not on the warrant. The HCOG is asking for renovations for the courthouse. The Smith Charities are asking for renovations to their property in downtown Northampton. The West family is offering 107 acres for permanent protection as agricultural land. They're asking for $50,000. Half of that would come from CPA. The other half would come from transfer development rights, or TDR funds. And the Heron property, number 20, we already voted this a while ago, but the process for protecting that with farmland has taken so long that when they reappraised the property, the values are higher by 10%, so it was a $90,000 project for us. They're coming back for the additional $9,000. We're trying to make this go away. So this may drop out anyways, but in anyways, CPA money would not impact tax rate, and TDR appropriations also don't affect tax rate.
So the money, so the CPA, the money the CPA gets is part of the taxes that come in, and then the Massachusetts matches a portion of that.
A portion, right.
So when we see the money coming in for CPA from taxes, where is that number?
The accountant has that number, so that the amount of taxes that gets paid in, so 3% surcharge on your property taxes above the first 100,000 of your house value. So if you have a $300,000 house, the first 100,000 is free, and then the second 200,000 gets a 3% surcharge that goes into CPA.
Oh.
We receive about $300,000 annually for that. You've got $1.8 million in CPA right now.
How much do we have?
You have about $1.8 million. So I'm all in favor of spending that $1.8 million down before we go to the taxpayers asking for loans on buildings. Mm-hmm. So
how much does the school want?
I believe 500.
How much was your thing?
1.7. But
it could be less.
I was proposing that we borrow CPA funds so mm-hmm. that you leverage that money for maximum impact.
Mm-hmm.
So I wouldn't be asking for the 1.7. I'd be asking to borrow the 1.7, and that would be paid off over a 10-year period or 20-year period, depending from those proceeds coming into CPA. And that way there's plenty of money for everything else.
I like that idea.
I did too. I thought it was pretty cool.
Well, let's present it again.
Article 23, this is the first of the planning board articles. This is just compliance with a new law requirement having to do with the length of time for special permits. Article 24 is the marijuana moratorium. Article 25 is reserved for the planning board. I don't know if they're going to use it or not. Article 26. It's a petition to a resolution, came in with 12 signatures, and has a non-binding resolution having to do with money in election campaigns.
There's a lot of chatter here.
Oops.
Do you foresee, like, any issues with any of these articles?
I think the senior tax work-off program is new and different, mm-hmm. and I can expect that it will generate a lot of debate.
What's the argument against?
Two reasons for this is that, in effect, you're giving a tax break to a class of people that not available to everybody. Some people may object to that.
Mm-hmm.
The other is that it does cost. You know, we're asking that we subsidize other people's property. So I've built in money into the balanced budget to cover those costs, but there'd be about a $10,000 cost to the town.
But that's cheaper than going out and hiring people.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you what people might object to.
So before you put this together, did you research? I'm sure you did the research with other area towns that are doing it. And so they do this, it's similar to what they do?
Yep.
And so when you were talking to them, did it, like, the first time they presented it, was it, like, an easy, you know, did they have issues that people didn't vote for it and had to come back?
A mixed bag. Some places adopted it right away. Some other places mm-hmm. had to go through a process of discernment and mm-hmm. adjustment. Okay. There are some complications having to do with taxes, federal and state taxes, so what gets reported. There are some complications having to do with discipline. All right, so if somebody is, in effect, becomes an employee of the town for a limited period and they do something which is counter to our personnel handbook, mm-hmm. what do you do in terms of disciplining that person?
Mm-hmm. Wouldn't they be subject to the same disciplinary rules as anyone else?
Yeah, but what does that look like in terms of the credit? You know, so let's say they work for, this is, they're on a stint for work for 11 weeks and they work half of it and then they do something that means that I have to fire them, in effect. What kind of impact upon the credits do they have? Does that have, you know, there's some complications there that we have to be clear about. So.
Well, I would think that they would get paid for the hours they worked and that's it.
Yeah.
I know that in my office, I would love to have somebody just come in and do the little tedious things I can't get to, like filing. And, you know, things like that. And
yeah, I think that ultimately it's a win-win. It helps helps out with the people who are on a fixed income.
And, of course, you're not going to put them where they see things that are, you know,
right.
like employee things, confidentiality issues
right.
and stuff like that.
Well,
but I think that
workers' comp and the insurance issues.
Yeah, well, there's those two. There's
are they
all
employees
these.
Employees or not, or they're volunteers.
Yeah, there are all these details that we're researching right now that we want to make sure that
someone's done it first and that also.
Yeah, the other people have done it already. So.
And I think it's a great thing, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
I think, you know, you're going to see people really kind of wanting to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Like a little thing, get them out of the house for a few hours, and they're earning something and to go towards something, and then that's it.
And it may take about 3 years for this to work. That
mm-hmm.
you know, the first year, let's say we adopt it, the first year people may not know about it, or they may be a little hesitant to come out. So you may have limited participation in years one and two, but then I think as people see the benefits, it should take off.
Well, like anything on the warrant or anything that gets voted on at town meeting, it kind of depends on how you sell it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So I don't really see one big hot topic this year, or this. I mean that this might be it, but so to keep people here the whole meeting, you know,
yeah.
unlike the tiny houses or the library.
That's
I was
true.
For those tiny houses. I'd like one in my backyard, please.
That's where you want to go live.
Yes.
Out in the backyard.
That's right.
I have no problem.
She's in
that.
The doghouse.
You taught me the term she shed.
Yeah.
She shed.
As opposed to band cave.
Yeah, that's right. So,
so.
I think the finance board, you know, we're new members, and, you know, I was kind of out of things for a while. I think that as far as our meeting, in trying to, you know, everything with budget things, we should probably set some meetings up.
I agree.
And then at some point, you know, when things get closer, you know, the departments that want to meet with us as well.
Mm-hmm.
I know we typically do it on Saturday mornings.
Don't do it on Saturday. Well, do it whenever you want, but make it easy on yourself.
I don't care to do them on Saturday mornings because, one, I work. I don't have to, but I do, and, you know, I kind of feel like I need the weekends for myself to,
mm-hmm.
so I would like to do it, like, maybe, you know, one day a week or something, or 2 days a week, kind of get it done, you know, like 7 to 9, or, you know.
I agree. Make it easy on yourself. I'll meet with you whenever you meet. If it's Saturday mornings, it'll be Saturday mornings, but.
I would vote down on Saturday mornings.
Yeah.
Now, exactly what before when we were meeting last
mm-hmm.
year and we were talking about Saturday mornings, that's when we were having all the department heads coming
mm-hmm.
in. We're not doing that this time because they're meeting with the select board.
Well,
and
we've been
attending.
If you wish.
They met with the select board last time, but if they wanted to come see us, we allowed it.
That's true. But us attending these meetings, I almost feel like they may not. That might not be necessary to have them present it again.
The way I feel about it is if they want to come see us, they should be able to have the opportunity to.
Well, it's a public meeting anyway.
Right.
So.
No, I mean, so we could, you know, if the departments want to see us, we can schedule a time for, this is when we're going to be doing this. If they want to come see us, then we can put them on the agenda.
The departments will meet with you as often as you need in order to get the information that you need in order to make the decisions that are going to be asked of you. So whatever your meeting schedule is and however many departments you need to meet with, we'll make it happen. But I think you should make it easy on yourselves. You're hearing the information at the same time as the select board. Is there anything that rises to the top? You've heard three sets of budgets at this point. Is there anything that rises to the top at this time? I think next week will be more difficult when we're talking about the education budget and the fire department budget, which there are many needs there that are not met. So it may be that you may want to focus in on a couple of strategic points in the budget process to meet, but make it easy on yourselves. You've got lives, you got responsibilities.
Mm-hmm.
There have been two budget hearings with select board so far.
Yep.
Right tonight. So one was last night, and that will be available to listen to. And what was it, 2 weeks ago? Do you know the date of the
Wednesday, the first.
Their YouTube are available through the website, so you can catch up on those or watch those hearings. Catch up. And I know last year, too, you would meet at the public safety complex. Mm-hmm. And I would put in a plug for a meeting here, because when you ask a question like, what's the balance in a certain account, I can go right next door and get that information for you.
Right.
So we have a lot of the information here, or we're looking up, what year did we pass that article? We have all the resources here, and David and I can get that information, and you can move on with a project. I know last year, if I didn't have my computer with me, or you'd set up your computer, that we couldn't always have those answers for you handy. And then it's, you know, your time is limited, and to get you the answers quickly, I think.
And here is fine with me.
Mm-hmm.
Although, where are all the people? There was like no place to park.
They're in the church.
Oh, I thought you were looking for an audience, Tom.
Well, no, I was like, well, there should be a half a dozen people here, yet there's no place to park. So they're allowed to tell them not to park in our parking lot. Go over there.
Yeah. It's better across Middle Street than it used to be since they paved. There's nice spaces over there.
So my understanding is next week there's a meeting, but that's the only one I have. Are we going on the 22nd, I don't believe there is anything. Maybe the 29th?
29th, they are going to hold a meeting. They decided that. They're going to formally vote that at next week's meeting, but I can tell you right now on the 29th.
They're going to do it again, probably 6:30.
But at some point, we have to meet just us to go through and vote on all the articles and so on.
Mm-hmm.
We just did three today.
Let me give you the time frame for what's happening.
Yes.
Okay, so on April 5th, the select board will try to finish up the warrant as best as possible. They'll send it off for legal review.
Hey, hang on a second.
Sure.
I was going to put them right in the calendar. But
I think you sent that in an email as well, didn't you?
Yeah, but it's good to go.
No, absolutely. I just wanted.
Okay, so the April 5th is when they hope to have the warrant settled.
Well, it's close enough for legal review. So I'll send the warrant and the motions out for legal review. April 12th. The select board are scheduled to sign and post the warrant. It would be good, but not necessary, to have the finance committee's recommendations on everything but the omnibus budget. We'll still be working on that at that point in time. So if you could go through the articles and decide which ones you want to make a recommendation on, and what your recommendation may be. That way I can have it in the printed, posted warrant.
Okay.
There have been many times when we've gone to town meeting where the finance committee has not made a final decision on articles, and we have recommendation pending, and then you give that recommendation from the floor. So that's fine. Voters don't like that so much.
I don't like that so much either. I'd rather think about it carefully and not be rushing to town meeting and doing it there.
Right.
There's always changes or things you're dealing with pretty much right up to the town meeting.
Well, I know, but we can dot as many I's and cross as many T's as we can before we get there, right?
We can try to.
So the select board are not scheduled right now to meet during that break week of the 19th, but they could.
All right, wait, so let's go through the calendar.
Okay.
So it's March, what's today? Today's the 9th. So what's happening on the 15th?
15th, we're talking education and fire and senior tax program.
Okay, so that's going to be big ones.
That's a big one.
And the senior tax thing. And that's on the 15th.
That's on the 15th.
Is that 6:30?
6:30.
Okay, so I have a meeting until 6. I don't have to rush here after that.
Okay, and the 22nd, we're off?
22nd, you're off.
But that might be a good week for us to meet.
Could be.
As a board. Mm-hmm. Like,
yep.
Do you agree? Okay.
Would you want to meet here on the 22nd?
Schedule. Is that the third Wednesday of the month?
Fourth.
Oh, fourth. Okay, so that's what you do. So I'm meeting then. Oh, I can't on the 22nd. I have a hearing. Can we do the 23rd?
I'm open.
Okay, so 23rd is going to be 9 a.m.
I'm open.
You're open?
Yeah, I'm open.
7 p.m.?
Yep.
7 p.m.
Writing you in on the big calendar.
Uh-oh.
Will you...
And the 29th is another select board?
Yep. No, they don't have...
They haven't scheduled anything.
They haven't scheduled anything, but I think they might continue the discussion about education and fire at that time.
Okay. So...
April 5th, they're going to do human services... Culture and Recreation.
April 5th. Human Services. And which else?
Cultural Recreation.
Is this something you have digitally that you can send to us?
Yep. Be happy to do that.
Like we're like scribbling stuff while you're telling us stuff and it's right here.
Okay. Remainder of general government and then debt state assessments and the unclassified. It seems like a lot, but... There's not a whole lot going on in those budgets.
We have no tri-board meetings, right? Are those on hold?
Those are on hold for right now.
And I'll watch that one on TV. It will not be. I have plans on the 5th.
Okay. And then the 12th, anything that's remaining. Mm-hmm. Now, the public forum may be on the 26th, so just be aware that it's right now it's written as 27th.
April,
they may push it off to the 26th. You don't have to be there.
Well, I missed the last one. I want to be there. This one.
Can we get a copy?
Of course, you may.
Okay, so that's.
And then 4th of May annual town meeting. We meet downstairs at 6 p.m. With the select board, and we just go over any last minute issues. We'll be meeting with the attorney and the moderator. And then at 7 o'clock, we wander over to town meeting.
So on May 3rd, if you all want to meet, you know, to go over what we're going to, at some point we'll discuss which ones we're going to speak about, you know, say it up and suggest. So if you want to, like, do a quick...
Dress rehearsal.
Yeah, dress rehearsal, and you'll have the talking points at that point.
Yeah, so we might want to do that ourselves on the 3rd.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you open on May 3rd?
Yes.
I don't think that they are, but I'll do a check-in.
So May 3rd is a
Wednesday.
Okay, at 7.
Okay. Yep.
So 5-3 finance.
It won't be a long one.
Well, it's okay.
No, I always build in some flex time into these schedules. So right now, April 12th, the select board are scheduled to sign the warrant.
And post it.
And post it. But they can go for another couple of weeks without running into legal problems doing that. So if they need to take additional time, it's built into the schedule.
Yeah, right. Have they ever been like on time or are they false?
Yeah, at the fall town meeting, they were really on time.
Oh, good.
So
this room is available on those dates that we'll need it then, correct?
One of them.
So
the May 3rd.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got you on May 3rd.
And then the other one was...
March 23rd.
Right, and then we might probably schedule one more.
So the March 23rd, we're going to go through the warrant articles and try to give our recommendations on all those, except for the one.
Mm-hmm. So we might have to schedule another one after that, if we don't get through everything.
That's on March 23rd.
Right. Are those days good for everybody?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Okay.
But we might, I mean, tentatively, we might want to do one more. I mean,
right, that's what I was saying, tentatively, we might.
Well, we can always, like, get together, you know, schedule something and meet, right? And
yeah.
As long as everybody can get there.
And as,
let's post it.
As we get closer, we'll be sitting down with calculators and we'll be doing
48 hours.
Doing all that magic of making things balance. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And maybe down the road, if we could think about, you know, is there maybe a particular time that we want to meet once a month, you know, if it's not in budget season?
I think we should meet the third Tuesday or
something like that.
Yeah.
Well, and there were other things that we were kind of looking at before. I was asking questions about commissions that exist now, if there's a... Would it be beneficial to get away, kind of changing our government is what kind of the way we were looking at it, and the benefits and the cost savings and so forth like that. So that's something I'd like to see picked up again, too. And David was very helpful, and Linda was helpful on that, too.
Yeah, you'll find a lot of discussion about that in this.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so looking at the change of government and how things are working.
Is there a good time? Better time?
Is 7 good for everybody?
7
or?
Works.
Yeah, 7's good for me. I mean,
seven
I came back from Boston today. So.
7's good, because if I have a conflict with work, I'm usually out by 6.
What day of the week? Any particular day of the week?
Well, I'm definitely committed on the first and third Wednesdays of the month and third Tuesday, and then they filter them in.
Thursdays is the most open day in general for this.
So Thursdays are typically always good for me.
Thursday tends to be Tuesdays, the select board
Wednesdays.
Right.
Yeah.
I like Thursdays.
Thursdays are really good for this,
right? Right after the select board, so we can...
No, let's take them to Thursdays, then.
Yeah.
Going to the first Thursday of the month, not in budget season?
Yeah.
Yeah, that would...
I like that.
I like that, too.
So in May and June, I'll be approaching you with year-end... cleanups stuff, asking for line item transfers from reserve funds, whatever we have to do in order to bring the FY18 17 budget in for a landing. So you'll be hearing from me. And I'll also start the capital plan upgrade in June. So we'll start gearing up for the fall town meeting. So you'll be hearing from me.
And is that a calendar she's writing on there? Does that get published somewhere?
This calendar is just for this room, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Someone wants to help. They're signing up for this room, but this published calendar is a posting
on the website.
If you go to www.hadleyma.org, you'll find a calendar of all the public postings.
So all of our meetings will be on there
as
well?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just
so
that.
No, that's just to reserve the room for you, so no one else meets.
We have to post it so far in advance.
48 hours. Not counting with holidays and weekends.
Right.
And I can see there are throngs of people in here.
There'll be more next time, Tom.
There's an active viewing audience.
Is there the same group of people come to all the...
There's a lot of... No, I'm at home in TV land.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
I'm...
Say hi.
Tom gets quiet.
Bye.
All right.
Well, I killed my cable company, so I just have Netflix. So unless it's on Netflix, I'm not going to ever see it.
YouTube.
Yeah, YouTube. I can do it on YouTube. Definitely.
So I guess we just need a motion to close, right? We're pretty much wrapped up for tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, make a motion to close.
A motion to close the meeting.
Second.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all so very much for the work that you do and any questions you may have.
Do you work until 9:30 every night?
I hope not.